all, there is a guardian watching it. Angels are pure thoughts from God, winged with truth and love. When man sleeps, his soul speaks to the angel. False dreams come from demons, true dreams come from angels. This world has angels all too few, and heaven is overflowing. Humanity raised its eyes to the heavens and discovered angels, extraordinary beings of beauty, grace, and power. For thousands of years, in a thousand interpretations, artists, theologians, poets, and philosophers have sought to capture their profound essence. In the first century, philosopher Philo said that each person experiences that divine expression differently. In the 20th century, Carl Jung declared, "The angel personifies something new arising from the deep unconscious." Throughout the ages, the angel has been a universal symbol of earthly aspirations to the divine.
And the wonderful thing is that they are in every religion. Every people have this vision that there is something more in our lives than what we can actually see with our physical eyes.
This is not a dream. Yeah. Life has a certain quality all its own, a certain feeling, and so do dreams. You know that this is not life. And you know now that this is not a dream. This is a place that comes after life and after dreams.
It's just crossing that line to whether or not you're going to make a logical, material world assessment based on what you know, or if you're going to make a leap of faith based on what you don't know.
Contemplating and considering the angels, studying them, we're very much looking at ourselves.
The softer aspect of angels is now emphasized, the angel as guardian angel, the angel as the alter ego, whether of an ordinary person or of an artist, is very much a part of New Age phenomena in the United States and therefore of popular culture.
Years it's been a rising wave of the idea and image of angels in contemporary culture in many ways. Historically, this wave has kind of come and gone many times throughout history.
Oh no, I've said too much. I set it up.
And the angels tie it at one.
But the spirit can wait to fly.
Well, I've had this picture of a guardian angel my whole life, yeah. And I've been writing about it my whole career. They've been with me.
I see an angel.
An angel? With wings?
Renewed interest in angels has found an articulate voice in Sophie Burnham, author of three best-selling books about angels.
When A Book of Angels was printed, there was an immediate response of relief, I guess is the word I would say. And I got hundreds of letters from people, and they say, "Oh, thank you for writing your book. I've never told my story to anyone, and now I know I'm not insane. I know I'm not alone." The response was so great that I brought out the second book, Angel Letters, and after that came this flood of other books on angels, and now we're in the midst of what seems to be an angel movement. It's even going international as it sweeps into Europe and Asia. And yet, I'm not saying anything that everybody doesn't know.
For centuries, angels have been a persistent idea and image in human life. Prophets dreamed of angels, mystics saw them, saints spoke with them, and the suffering prayed to them. For many, belief in angels begins in the traditional scriptures of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, ancient stories that cross cultural differences and religious lines. In the book of Genesis, cherubim with flaming swords watch over the tree of life. When Adam and Eve taste the forbidden fruit, it is a fierce emissary of God that drives them out of the Garden of Eden. The Talmud, the Kabbalah, and other sacred writings are rich with the stories of powerful, mysterious angels. And Muhammad dictated the surahs of the Quran at the command of the archangel Gabriel. Ancient civilizations were filled with ideas and images of superhuman winged beings. But our classic view of angels flew from the brushes of Renaissance painters, colorfully winged, richly robed, wondrous beings who re-illuminated the human mind and spirit from the darkness of the Middle Ages. In the Age of Reason, when religious beliefs were being questioned, philosophers asserted that angels must exist to fill what would otherwise seem to be a gap in the natural order of creation. St. Thomas Aquinas declared, "The universe would be incomplete without them." As civilizations grew, cities celebrated angels with images flying over the rooftops, on buildings and churches, or grandly victorious and uplifting on public monuments. Today, almost 70% of Americans believe in angels. In every age, humanity's reach for the divine has embraced them. Angel comes from the Greek word angelos, meaning messenger, and some of the world's greatest legends are accounts of angels appearing to humans on a divine mission. In the New Testament book of Luke, the Archangel Gabriel is sent by God to a virgin in the town of Nazareth to deliver his message. "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus." The Annunciation is one of the most often painted scenes in Christian art. Thousands of artists have interpreted the story in their own way. In the earliest paintings, Gabriel is usually the dominant figure, towering over a submissive Mary. Over time, they are depicted more or less as equals. And in later interpretations, it is Gabriel who kneels reverently to the vessel of purity who is to become the queen of the angels. In Christianity, the Annunciation is Gabriel's most well-known and beloved role, but he is also called the angel of heavenly mercy, resurrection, and revelation. Other religions look to the Archangel Gabriel for divine attributes and inspiration. In Jewish literature, Gabriel is the angel of judgment, presiding over all that is powerful. In Islam, he is the angel of humanity, the spirit of truth, and the prince of the guardian angels. Sufi Respahan Bakhli described his vision of the Archangel. "I saw Gabriel like a maiden, or like the moon amongst the stars. He is the most beautiful of angels. His face is like a red rose."
They come to to help us, and they come in any form that we can receive them. So they will come as intuition, for example, that little tap on the shoulder that says, go here, don't go there. And we've all had that idea of, I knew I shouldn't have gone down that road and I didn't listen. Or they come as dreams or as sudden miraculous coincidences, synchronicities that we can't explain.
I can't see you, but I know you're here. I feel it. I wish I could see your face because there are so many things I want to tell you.
In Wim Wenders' film, Wings of Desire, the dreams of angels fuse with those of their human charges. Compassion ignites passion.
Als das Kind Kind war, war das die Zeit der folgenden Fragen. Warum bin ich ich und warum nicht du? Warum bin ich hier und warum nicht dort? Wann begann die Zeit und wo endet der Raum? Ist das Leben unter der Sonne nicht bloß ein Traum?
I believe that we live like fish in water in this spiritual realm, and we don't know that we're living in it because the noise and tactileness of this physical world is so powerful that we don't know it. And in this spiritual realm, there are beings rising up like flames and dying out and rising up, and we call these angels.
The rabbis have said that angels can fly, angels can walk, angels are made of half water, half fire. But in the Jewish tradition, an angel can take a variety of forms. One can imagine an angel taking human form. One can imagine an angel simply being a voice. When you think of the idea of angel in a large way, meaning any presence that mediates the ultimate God to the human realm, one can call, in a sense, a malach, an angel.
For centuries, scholars have attempted to number, order, and name the angels, as if creating a kind of heavenly hierarchy would help to explain their divine realm.
Sometimes it seems things about God and heaven must be so far beyond our ability to comprehend. Our little ideas about them are silly. They're so much more than anything we could perceive. And yet, who knows? Maybe by believing in them, we make them real.
Saint Ambrose, the 4th century Bishop of Milan, introduced a 9-tiered ranking of the angels. In descending order, he named them seraphim, cherubim, dominions, thrones, principalities, powers, virtues, archangels, angels. The higher orders were closer in nature to God. The lower orders attended to humankind. This order prevailed for 2 centuries until Pseudo-Dionysius revised the list and reversed the order of the thrones and dominions, the principalities and the virtues. Dionysius also divided the 9 choirs of angels into groups of 3. The first hierarchy performed the acts of God in heaven. The mighty 6-winged seraphim are nearest to God. The cherubim are blessed with fullness of knowledge and consecrated wisdom. The thrones were perceived as the sovereign light of unerring judgment. Some saw them as raw energy like supernovas, whirling in space, and called them wheels. The second hierarchy regulate heaven and earth. The dominions oversee the duties of all the angels on heaven and earth. The virtues are associated with heroes and those who struggle for good. The powers balance and reconcile opposites, good and evil. The third hierarchy act in divine service to humankind. The principalities are in charge of the great nations and cities on earth. There are just seven archangels, powerful beings who dominate our literary and artistic culture. Their names may differ from one religion to another, but all include Michael, Gabriel, and Raphael. The last order of the celestial hierarchy, the angels, is the one closest to man, undertaking the ministry of guardianship with purity of spirit. Although the Dionysian order is the most renowned, many other attempts at ordering the angels have been made over the centuries. As recently as 1975, American evangelist Billy Graham declared there are not nine, but 10 tiers of angels. History leaves little doubt that more changes will come in time. If the desire to know angels begins with assigning them places in a man-made hierarchy, it gains brilliant expression in the hands of artists. The Tiffany windows of St. Michael's Church in New York City bear eloquent witness to the breadth of the inspiration of angels. The celestial hierarchies are envisioned in seven majestic windows. A multitude of angels climbs to the heavens. The upper portion of the windows are illuminated by daylight, which appears to emanate directly from the throne of God. The choirs are so massed they seem to illustrate the words of Christ. Thinkest thou that I cannot pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? In the lower portion of the central window is the magnificent figure of Michael, the triumphant leader of the seven archangels, holding the lance of authority and the banner of resurrection. It is the sublime moment of victory when he freed the court of heaven from the disobedient angels, who in their pride had dared to raise their wills against their Creator. The dramatic story of a war among angels, raging in heaven before earth was even formed, is based on just three short verses in the New Testament book of Revelation. It begins, "And there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought, and his angels, and prevailed not." The great 17th century poet, John Milton, put forth what he considered the first test of free will, the fall of the angels. Through poetry, Milton articulates one of humanity's elemental explanations of the presence of evil in the world in his masterpiece, Paradise Lost. His story begins when Lucifer, the most powerful angel, is ordered to obey the Son of God. Lucifer refuses. The rebellious angels join him and storm out to challenge the power of God. On the first day, one of the powerful seraphim and Lucifer meet. Angel battles angel. On the second day, Michael enters the fray. Now storming fury rose and clamor such as heard in heaven till now was never. Michael wounds Lucifer, now known as Satan. Then Satan first knew pain. Michael asks for assistance, and on the third day, the Son of God rides forth. He drove them before him, thunderstruck, pursued with terrors and with furies, to the bounds and crystal wall of heaven. A spacious gap disclosed into the wasteful deep. Headlong themselves they threw down from the verge of heaven. Eternal wrath burnt after them to the bottomless pit. The war in heaven is over, but Satan is far from finished. God has created a new race. Satan turns serpent and plans to seduce them. The struggle between good and evil begins.
According to most religions, there is this idea of a fallen angel whose function is to create chaos and violence, hatred, pain, terror. I know that I don't want to know much about it. I guess I'm afraid of it because I do believe in it.
The Prophet Muhammad said, "Even every raindrop is accompanied by an angel." The mystery and power of angels are believed to reach beyond the sun, the moon, the stars.
Angels were thought to guide and propel the stars and so ordered all of the movement of the cosmology. Angels are, in a sense, what we would consider to be, in a scientific age, the laws of nature. There's an order and a sense of intelligence behind that law that happens every time for a particular reason. And we call those laws of nature. In the past, those have been considered to be angels, that intelligence. So in every level of creation, angels were looking out for everything.
For all their majesty and omniscience, angels appear most often giving compassionate assistance to individuals. There is general agreement that the purpose of angels is to act in the service of God, in heaven, on earth, or as intermediaries between the two. Angels perform many roles, the most dramatic perhaps as protector and rescuer of the righteous. Angels appear with timely concern, not only to protect, but to give us strength in time of fear, weakness, or doubt. For many, angels act as spiritual guides on life's journey. This artist envisions Sir Galahad, the purest of King Arthur's Knights of the Round Table, crossing the water with the help of an angelic oarsman in his quest for the Holy Grail. The Jewish Kabbalah says that angels guide human ability to acquire intellectual knowledge. St. Thomas Aquinas observed, "Sometimes a man's understanding is enlightened by an angel to know what is good, but it is not instructed as to the reason why."
But our God is very removed, this Judeo-Christian Muslim God, and therefore we have angels as intermediaries.
For some, angels bridge that religious gap, just as they did in the book of Genesis on Jacob's ladder, angels ascending and descending on a ladder that stretches between heaven and earth. As intermediaries between heaven and earth, God and humankind, angels perform three key roles: messengers, recorders, and carriers of souls to heaven. Many of the best-known and enduring legends come from accounts of angels appearing to humans as divine emissaries. Perhaps the most celebrated message was delivered to the shepherds in Bethlehem, announcing the birth of Christ. "Fear not, for I bring you glad tidings of great joy." The traffic between heaven and earth is decidedly not one way. Angels carry man's prayer for guidance and protection to the heavens.
There's a prayer in the bedtime service, a little couple pages that a traditional Jew reads before sleeping, that positions the angels around one's bed to protect you from, I guess, demons at night. And when my children were little, I used to help them position the angels so they would feel that they went to sleep guarded by divine energy.
It is said that just before we are born, an angel holds his finger to our lips and whispers, "Hush, don't tell what you know." And this is why we have a cleft on our upper lip and remember nothing of where we came from.
And I think children feel they can still speak to them. They still feel like they're hearing them.
Jetzt schläfst du, Reisa. Und in deinem Kindertraum purzeln die Bilder vom Tage und alle deine Erinnerungen drunter und drüber. Ich sehe sie vor mir und auch du siehst mich, wenn auch nur im Traum. Du weißt, dass ich bei dir bin. Wenn du dir doch dieses Wissen erhalten könntest und es dir nicht gleich beim Erwachsenwerden austreiben ließest.
Charlotte, my daughter, has done two or three really amazing things. But one of the most stunning was, we've never gone to church. We never pray. I'd never had any discussions with her about God. She was 3 and a half, and we sat down to eat, and she said, "Wait, Mother. This is Charlotte. Hello to all the angels and God. I'm here and I'm doing very well and I want to let you know." And she went on with this long, incredible prayer for about, 4 minutes. It was really stunning. They're very near to God when they're born, and little by little they learn this world. But while they're still 6 and 5 and 7, once in a while they'll turn and go, "Shh."
Most angels live just for one day. They come into being, sing the praises of God, go on individual missions, and sink into Nahal Dinur, the river of fire. Okay? And then other angels are born out of that again, a brand new set.
The angels who act as the recorders and the reporters of the deeds of humans have become a strong idea in the human conscience. As this 20th century artist illustrated, the recording angel awaits, book at hand, checking credits and debits when one sheds the manacles of life. The guardian angel waits nearby, hoping for a positive balance so that she may present the crown of roses. The galleries are filled with angels who listen as intently as any earthly jury. According to the Apocalypse of St. Paul, this accounting occurs daily at the hour of morning, which is the 12th hour of the night, midnight, more associated with mystery and evil than the chores of keeping life's ledger. Only the souls of mortals are allowed to enter heaven, but in Christianity, both the body and soul of Mary, escorted by legions of angels, were assumed into paradise, where she was crowned the Queen of Heaven. Scholars suggested that because Mary is not quite as holy as her son, she required the assistance of angels to attain her exalted place in paradise. The three great Marianic legends, the Annunciation, the Nativity, and the Assumption, are the subjects of more classical paintings than any other stories, and there is always an angelic presence. Ancient masters of art no doubt painted from what they knew. A royal band accompanying the Virgin on her first rise towards the center of heaven lend pageantry to the act of coronation, as in any earthly ceremony. At the same time, they solidified the correlation between the beauty of the heavenly kingdom and the beauty of the higher communication of music. Music itself was considered a form of divine expression.
I think music is a deeper communication than anything else we're able to do. It speaks to all people.
Transcendental force of music is so powerful that it has often been thought of as the bridge between humans and the divine. The Paris Opera overflows with these heavenly beings. Many ancient cultures believed that celestial music kept the universe in motion. In 1964, angels as musicians flew from their customary place on the domes of churches when Marc Chagall adorned the ceiling of the elegant Paris Opera with his own distinctively stylized and vibrantly colored angels. Chagall's work is as divinely inspired as the music that poured from the brilliant minds and hands of composers named in the dome. Graceful seraphs float and dance across the magnificent ceiling. musical angel soars on outspread wings, literally embodying her celestial cello. Great artists, from Michelangelo to Marc Chagall, and legions of unknowns, have painted angels on the ceilings of churches and structures, grand and humble. Because angels are near to God in character and grace, and live in close proximity to Him, we envision them in the air, floating above us, divine, pure, and powerful. The melodious sound of their wings is heard in the realms above. Symbol of Angels in America, the Tony Award and Pulitzer Prize winning play about crisis, compassion, and AIDS by Tony Kushner.
I had an idea that if you were dealing with death, if you were dealing with loss, if you were dealing with pain and suffering, that you would also be dealing with angels. I always knew that she would be winged. Probably my clearest image of her was the image of the angel at Bethesda Fountain, which is the most beautiful angel statue, I think, in the world, at least the one that moves me the most. She looks and feels like an American angel. I think that there is a connection between angels and the past, and I mean, angels are also images of grief and mourning, the Bethesda angel is.
The Angel of the Waters, striding above the Bethesda Fountain in Central Park, is based on the biblical story of an angel that, from time to time, came down into the Pool of Bethesda in Jerusalem, infusing the waters with divine powers that could heal the sick, that could restore a suffering body and mind. When God said in Genesis, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness," some presumed he was speaking to his angels. Angels have fueled the creative spirit for centuries. Artists transform wings of paper, canvas, marble, or bronze into uplifting creations that endure beyond their times. 17th century artist and architect Gian Lorenzo Bernini created masterful sculptures of angels that still grace the streets and churches of modern Rome. Chapel, Bernini's masterwork, Ecstasy of Saint Teresa, echoes her story of spiritual passion. Saint Teresa described the angel she saw. He was very beautiful and his face aflame. In his hand, I saw a great golden spear, which he plunged into my heart and left me consumed by the great love of God. Humanity is often declared angels as morally and spiritually perfect beings. At the Church of Sant'Andrea delle Frate, Bernini's masterful creations of the angel with superscription and angel with crown of thorns make manifest the ideas of purity, grace, and divinity.
The normal way for an angel to look, of course, is to be a kind of androgynous human being, sort of half female or half male, with a huge set of wings. which biologically he or she couldn't possibly operate because they don't have a deep enough chest. But another kind of angel that you see a lot in classical art, in ancient art, and also in recent art, is the puto, the little baby angel. They appear in vast numbers in 17th and 18th century European art, and not just in religious contexts, that they get to be translated out of the realm of religion, pure and simple, and into ordinary life. And I suppose there were people who believed that these angels did in fact exist and are to be invisibly sensed in the air around us.
Some people can see them and some people can't. And if you can't see them, it does not mean that you are any less important or valuable or inferior to the person who can. And if you can see it, it doesn't mean that you're any better.
If we can listen carefully, God is present to us and speaking to us at crucial junctures in our life. And that's one of the things that we mean by angel.
Since we are approaching the year 2000 all too quickly, since there are millennial expectations inevitably, since there are always yearnings for apocalypse and fears and dread of apocalypse coming together, I think it's inevitable that angels and everything associated with angels have this enormous popular revival.
One of the things that I was interested in writing a book of angels was whether they appeared in all cultures. I had no interest at all in the fact that there might have been angels at the birth of the Son of God 2,000 years ago. I wanted to know if there were angels now for me, and if there were, whether it meant that there were Buddhist angels, Hindu angels, non-Christian angels, Jewish angels, Muslim angels.
I told you I'm your guardian angel. I know everything about you.
Well, you look about like the kind of an angel I'd get. Sort of a fallen angel, aren't you? What happened to your wings?
I haven't won my wings yet. That's why I'm an angel second class.
We absolutely adore the idea that there is somebody up there watching over us.
The idea of an angel assigned to a human being as a compassionate, heaven-sent guardian is a cherished tradition and one that often begins in childhood. In early times, it was thought every person was watched over by two angels, one good, one bad. Even today, some children are taught that a good angel sits on their right shoulder and a devil on their left, and they can listen to the whispered advice of either. Belief in the idea may fade with maturity, but there is enduring faith that a single caring attendant touches one's life from birth and becomes a constant guiding presence throughout life's journey. To represent a higher form of love and wisdom that can sustain one through the fears and dangers of human existence, a source of inner security, comfort, and protection. well-known archangels, Michael, Raphael, and Gabriel, Raphael is perhaps closest to mankind. In Christian belief, he is chief of the guardian angels and protects the young and the innocent. In Hebrew, his name means the shining one who heals, and he is charged with the caring and healing of mankind and the earth itself. Raphael speaks of his charge in American poet James Merrill's The Changing Light at Sandover. I hear the feet, the movements of his creatures, the slither, the stampede. I hear the cries of trees cut, too many. I hear the lessening of a breed. I listen, make sense of it, and report to my father. In nearly every religion, mythology, tradition, or tribal custom, there is a being, usually with wings, who acts as an intermediary between the earthly and the heavenly, between the physical and the spiritual, between the concrete and the abstract, a being who walks in the innermost of worlds. Personify a very deep longing in the human heart, crossing differences of time, place, and culture with equal facility, and inspiring among their human charges a desire to know them, to walk with them. For angels embody the virtues that humans imagine they might find within themselves. The Jewish Book of Creation defines angels as being born of four heavenly elements: mercy, strength, beauty, and dominion. The quest to attain these virtues has inspired humankind for centuries, not only to revere, but to emulate the angels. Though they are depicted with human form, angels are commonly thought to be superhuman in size, strength, and knowledge, and to possess the unearthly power to travel the universe at will, through all barriers, and at a speed even faster than light. Thus they soar above humankind, not only in virtue and grace, but in the physical realm, on the strength of wings.
They come sometimes with wings, sometimes without. They don't need wings. But because they're formed of light, and because they move as fast as thought, they are always depicted. Symbolically, the wings are important, like the wings of Mercury, that mean speed and light and swiftness.
Plato observed that the function of the wing is to take what is heavy and raise it up in the region above. Wings have come to identify angels as divine beings and explain their ability to traverse the heavens. While the place of angels in each culture may change, wings remain an absolute symbol for a free spirit and limitless power that can transcend the earth and its suffering.
I believe they can do anything at all, that they can interfere with all of the rules of the universe, all of the physical laws, but they cannot interfere with man's free will.
I think you have higher eyes that have an overview of your life and understand the future and the past in ways that you don't.
Ihr, die wir lieben, ihr seht uns nicht, ihr hört uns nicht, ihr wähnt uns in weiter Ferne. Doch sind wir so nah. Wir sind Boten, die Nähe zu tragen zu denen in der Ferne. Wir sind Boten, das Licht zu tragen zu denen im Dunkeln. Wir sind Boten, das Wort zu tragen zu denen, die fragen. Wir sind nicht Licht, wir sind nicht Botschaft. Wir sind die Boten. Wir sind nichts.
declared, it is not known precisely where angels dwell, whether in the air, in the void, or the planets. The search for angels always begins with a heavenward glance, for humankind does not look to itself for evidence of divine inspiration. Yet the desire to know angels, to analyze them, to classify them, has been cautioned. Philosophy, said the poet John Keats, will clip an angel's wings.
We're trying to bring down to our level of understanding what angels are, and I think that it's something that's beyond human understanding to do that. So I think it works better the other way if we kind of expand ourselves and push ourselves a little bit beyond our normal thinking and believing to maybe see them where they are.
When human beings perform extraordinary acts, we often compare them to angels.
I think that if there is a God and if there are angels, he or she and the angels expect people to behave decently towards one another.
I have a simple feeling that good deeds, good thoughts, which is an old religious idea, but good deeds, good thoughts, being a good person feeds a kind of embryonic sac that we all live in. And bad deeds and bad thoughts kill the embryonic sac we all live in.
Angels have been a part of this world for as long as humankind has recorded thoughts and dreams. They are part of how we view the mystery and wonder of the universe, the world, and life itself. It is a traditional Catholic belief that not merely every just man, every child of grace, but in fact every single human being, whether Christian or non-Christian, whether in grace or sin, remains during its entire life under the care of an angel.
If children can see it, if all religions see it, if all peoples in all cultures, not religions, but all peoples in all cultures can see it, then it means something.
To think of angels, to speak of angels, to believe in angels, is to join the ranks of humanity through centuries who have aspired to include angelic virtues in the human realm, in thoughts, deeds, words, or song.
Our exploring the angels moves us sort of into their realm a little bit, and I think that that's a good thing.
There are lots of good reasons for people to believe that there are powers that we don't understand and that there is more than simply what we can see in the world.
I feel something is at work. I don't know what it is, but it's more than I am by myself.
Angels are a bridge to the divine, mercy, peace, and goodness given form, in a universe that would be incomplete without them.
There's a lot I don't understand. There's a lot I will never understand, because basically what we're talking about is a mystery. The mystery of the spiritual.
Angels invite us to look up and reveal to us pieces of ourselves, not only in what should be, but what can be. Angels remain among us, persisting in our collective memory, where their power to influence, to guide, and teach humankind is truly given wings.